you care to, if you would please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we lift up our hearts to you this morning with praise and thanksgiving for being allowed to see this day. And what a beautiful day you have given us, Lord. We just pray for those whose lives have been impacted or may be impacted by the storm over Bermuda, that in your mercy, Lord, you would guide the storm away, but through your power and your might, that all things might be revealed, and that all things will work to your glory, Lord, in the end. And we just pray that your hand of blessing and mercy would be on this body as we do the people's work this morning, that you would help guide us into making good decisions for the people, and that we would serve them well, Lord, that you would make us worthy of the calling that you have put before us. We pray for all those who work in their lives to better the lives of other people, who risk their own personal safety or other things to bless other people and to help them to be stronger and better, Lord, whether it's teachers or police officers or military overseas. We just pray that they would feel your presence and your power with them today, Lord. Thank you for allowing us to live in this great nation. We just pray that you would continue to guide and bless this nation in the years to come, Lord, as you have blessed and guided it. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
If you would please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, do we have any public speakers this morning? I do not have a public speaker book. I guess Tori's going to run and fetch that. While she goes to get the public speaker book, let me just remind everybody that this is a 9 o'clock meeting. If you parked in the street, the city of Graham will be monitoring how long you're parked in your parking spot. And you may want to, at 11 o'clock, if we're still here, you might want to go move your car. Also, if you could, I think that they probably took your cell phone away from you downstairs for security reasons, because this is a courthouse, as well as being the commissioner meeting room. But if they didn't take your phone, please turn it off and silence it. Okay, we do have some people signed up to make public comments, but they're all non-agenda related items, and so we will not have any public speakers at this time. So therefore, we do not have any commissioner responses. Next on the agenda is to approve the agenda. Before we have a motion to approve the agenda, we do have one amendment to it. We have a request to move the budget amendment for the health department, item 8-1, up to between item 7-2 and 7-3, between the Board of Health appointment for the nurse position and the Alamance County appointed staff job descriptions. And that is to be thoughtful of the time of one of our county staff people. So if I could have a motion to amend the agenda to move. Okay, I have a motion and a second. To amend the budget. I'm looking at the word budget. Motion and a second to amend the agenda. If all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, then we would need a motion to approve the agenda as amended.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve the agenda as amended. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Next, we have several items, a few items on the consent agenda.
I'll move to accept it as written.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Great. All right, next we have Kara Townsend from the United States Census Bureau. She's a representative for the state of North Carolina. She can give us her exact title. Kara is here to tell us about the census for 2020 and how important it is that we all, and also Marlena is here from our GIS department, to Marlena Isley, to join in that presentation. So come on up, tell us all about the census.
Good morning, commissioners. I'm Marlena, as Amy introduced me, and Kara Townsend is our census partnership specialist, and she's going to give a presentation this morning regarding the census. that's upcoming for April of 2020 and how important it is for Alamance County and the state to participate in that.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Hello. Thank you for having me on this beautiful Tuesday after Labor Day weekend, and how refreshing it was to open with a prayer to get things going this morning. Well, I am, as Marlena mentioned, with the Census Bureau. I have about a 12-county radius, and I'm here to tell you about why it's important to care about the census and how important it is, which many of us already know. So I am based out of the Atlanta region. I live in Kernersville, North Carolina. I'm a native here, but that is our base for several of the southern states. So as many of you know, the census has been around for quite a while. Started in 1790, right after George Washington became president and around the first Congress. So we have quite a different count today at about 329 million people. But it's important, and it's constitutional, and everyone is actually required to do it. I know a lot of people don't, but that's why I'm here.
Kara, can I ask you something?
Yes.
If you could address your comments mostly to the board, because there's a camera on you, and when you look at the audience, I think it makes it hard.
That'll be weird.
Oh, I don't want to get
shot.
Okay, we want you to have a really good video.
Don't be nervous.
Not the back of your
head. Okay.
I'm sorry to interrupt.
No, you're fine, Amy. No, not at all. Okay. So the census is really about two different things. It's about power and money. Power being about the reapportionment of congressional districts. North Carolina is slated to get possibly one or two new congressional seats. It also deals with local redistricting as well. The second thing is it's about money. So every year the census, the United States government doles out about $675 billion to the states. North Carolina gets around $17 billion of that. But as you know, the census is conducted every 10 years, and so whatever count we get is the money that we will be allotted for the next 10 years. So it's important to get that count accurate. Here is a nice map that can show you what the congressional seats, how they changed in 2010. Texas got three new seats, for example. New York lost one. We did not gain any here. The next map is what it will probably look like after the 2020 census. So Texas will get another three seats. That's quite a bit of congressional power they will have. And as you all know, we count everyone in the census, not just citizens. So North Carolina, we're expected to get one or two, but it's quite an interesting map. And as we know, there are only 435 seats, so we're competing with other states to get those seats.
I ask a question.
Yes, sir.
Where do we rank out of the states 50 with the numbers of reps?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know the answer to that, but
well,
I would find out.
12th in population, are we 10th?
I thought we were 9th.
9th, okay.
But so that's probably changing.
It's probably close.
Okay. I mean, I know that I worked for AARP in a previous lifetime, and I know that in terms of retirement, we're going to be growing quite a bit over the next 20 years, but I can find that out for you.
No, it's okay.
It's a good question.
Comparable to population.
I should know that. here are your neighbors, the other counties, and these are our percentages from 2000 and 2010 in terms of the census. Governor Cooper, our state goal is 83% response rate, and we can do that. That is possible if we look and find all those hard to count populations that we don't normally get. So just to kind of give you an idea, so the state budget, we had asked for $750,000. We asked for $1 million. The House agreed to $750,000, the Senate agreed to zero. So we don't have a state budget in North Carolina for the census. So Wake County, just to give you an example of how other counties are investing in it, Wake County is investing over $400,000 as well as Mecklenburg. They are hiring a census staff person and also doing a professional campaign because we really are competing with all those other counties for those new seats. So that's a good idea, just kind of see where we are. So here are some of our target populations. In 2010, 1 million children were not counted across the country, which is a problem. Just because all of the federal government funding is associated with the census, just you can imagine that if a lot of kids weren't counted in a particular county, what would happen to schools? We'd have a lot more trailers added on. It just really creates havoc for a lot of these systems. Homeless is a big deal here. We're really focusing on that. Also for our senior citizens, I will explain later that this census is going to be electronic. So by March 30th, you will receive a postcard in the mail with a barcode that will be able to be scanned with your electronic device, whether that be your iPad or your phone. You can also request a paper questionnaire, and there is also a number to call, but this is an extra step that will require a lot of people to take, you know, an extra step. And seniors might not be interested in responding. A lot of people don't have electronic devices, so that's a focus area, especially in North Carolina.
So if you're homeless, if a target is homeless, how are you going to contact somebody with no mailing address and no electronic device?
So with homeless populations, we count, you know, where they're sleeping. So any kind of center they're sleeping at, shelter, we count those. We just get a count on April 1st of who is living in or staying the night in those shelters. It gets tricky because that's also an issue with the college population. So you're counted wherever you live on April 1st. So we can count people who live in the dorms. The RAs will count those people. But, you know, Guilford County, for example, has 6 colleges. It's hard to count, you know, who lives off campus because a lot of those cards are going to their parents' house. So we're trying to deal with that issue. But another big, surprisingly big population in North Carolina is migrant farm workers. So we have a person dedicated to that population because a lot of these people are coming in and we count them. They count for our funding. So that's another focus area.
How do they count seniors that are like in assisted living, you know, because most of them don't have electronic.
Yes, the same way as they count people in dormitories. And same goes for prisons. That's also another way we count them. And an interesting thing I pointed out to the chairwoman, in this area, in particular, a lot of people who are coming out of the prison population are coming to Alamance and Guilford County. Not so much Mecklenburg and Wake. So that's a pretty significant population. I can just tell you in 2016, the map, that was around 20,000 people. So it's important for us to be working with the law enforcement community to find where these people are. So they're counted as well. Oh, and this is my next slide. This just kind of gives you an idea of some of the different funding that goes for this. Transportation being a big one for us being the second after Texas and having the most highways. Also, our housing is impacted. So this is a big one going on this year with the confidentiality issue. So we really want to make sure that we involved all the trusted leaders in the community in the census, because the census is confidential. We only collect household data. We do not collect any personal data, and people can rest assured that their information is private. We are not going to report them to ICE. We're not going to report them to Homeland Security. They will benefit, and their families will benefit if they respond versus if they don't. I am sworn to secrecy for life. So if I ever say anything, I will end up in an orange jumpsuit, and I don't think that's great in orange. So I'm gonna not do that. But this is important to present to the community. Here's something that we're really gonna promote to seniors, that, you know, we're never going to ask for your Social Security number. No one is ever going to call you from the census. So just like in every big endeavor, people are going to try to take advantage of people during the census, especially when they find out that it's electronic. So we're really trying to focus, you know, our attention on them. Just to give you an example, so my computer, people try to break into the census 40,000 times a day. So we almost have an eye scanner to get into our computer system. So that just gives you an idea of the fraud that could potentially happen. Like I said, that phone or internet is how we're going to be responding this way. The government will be saving about $500 billion by doing this. So it's worth it, but we need to make sure we balance that with people who don't have electronic devices. The census stores a lot of information. I did not realize this until I started working for them. But we have all the export-import data. We also do other surveys that are pretty significant. One is the American Community Survey, which is the long form. The census form is probably about only 10 questions. But something that I do want to mention is we have a lot of experts here in the state to help businesses determine where the best places to put their business. We have significant demographics data. So if there is any concern with the chamber or if anyone would like help with that, we can set them up with someone. This is, we are working to establish complete count committees in all of our counties. So that starts at the county level, but we're also encouraging different groups to form complete count committees. And what those are is basically a group of professionals dealing with these different populations. So healthcare, transportation, housing. We like people on there from the business community, but a lot of faith-based organizations are also hosting their own complete count committees. And basically what they're doing is not reinventing the wheel, but looking at, events in the community that we can tag the census onto, just for educating on what the census is about. Oops, let me go back, that's okay. Well, so lastly, I'll end with jobs. So the census is hiring about 6,000 people in the state of North Carolina. And it's important that we tell our communities about this because we want people in the community, that others trust working for the census. They're great jobs. A lot of them pay $12 to $22 an hour. My position is salaried, but it's also contract. All of our jobs are contracted, but they're very flexible. So a lot of them work from home. So that's something to tell your community about. But I am open for questions.
Yeah. I do have one. Years ago, it may have been the last census over in Greensboro, the Spring Valley Shopping Center. They had they had a bunch of people they had hired to go out to do. What did they do, and how many, for instance, are any of those centers going to be in Alamance County, or is it all Guilford, or what?
I don't know exactly where all the centers will be at. We're just starting to open them. So we have one in Wake County, we have one in Mecklenburg, and I believe we're going to have one in Forsyth so far. But there will be all kinds of jobs, from supervisory level to, we'll have some people who are going door-to-door, not as many as we've had in the past, but there's a huge array of positions available. And you can find those on censusjobs.gov or usajobs.gov, is the more salaried positions.
How long does that job last?
At least until probably October of 2020.
Well, I want to update the board that she mentioned the complete count committees. Marlena Isley has been working on putting together a complete count committee for Alamance County. And it's a long list of people involved in county government and municipal government and the faith-based community Impact Alamance, all kind of different people from the community who are going to have a big meeting in Alamance County on September 10th. And so we are working hard to make that happen. We also have an executive committee that is in the process of being put together, and I'm happy to say that people such as Alan Gant and Effie Hornaday have agreed to be on that executive committee to help lead and guide and direct our census efforts. And we're going to have an executive committee meeting on October 10th at 9 o'clock, and we hope that the press will be there and help draw attention to this really important effort. Also, I've talked to Tracy Grazier at Impact Alamance. She's going to be on that executive committee as well. And she tells me that she thinks Impact Alamance may have some funding available to help us out with paying for it. But she wasn't sure when we talked, and I hope I'm not getting in trouble with her for talking about it, but I don't think she'll mind, she doesn't know how much it will be, and we kind of need to know what we're going to spend it on before they can approve us. They're not going to just hand us cash, and then we do whatever they'd like to know what our plan is with that. So that would be really good. The question of how to best reach people. And I think that some people, you know, you hear a lot in politics and national politics talking about who should and shouldn't be counted. Well, the decision's been made who should be counted, so we need to make sure that everyone is counted. Kara, could you go back to your the big map with the apportionment of the U.S. House of Representatives based on the 2010 Senate? Actually, the census projections for the 2020 congressional reapportionment. This map right here, I think, is so important to see that we hope we stand to maybe gain one seat, one congressional seat. But if we don't do our job, it's not going to happen, and it's going to go somewhere else. And I say that if the people in Texas are counting all the migrant workers, you better be sure that the people in North Carolina count all our migrant workers, or the people who are not here with documentation, or the children, anybody. If they're going to count them in Texas, if they're going to count them in California and Florida and New York, we need to make sure that they're counted in North Carolina too. And this is really refreshing and fun to have what's truly a nonpartisan issue that we can all pull together and work hard together for, because we're all North Carolinians, and we need to make sure that we're represented nationally in proportion to our numbers.
Yes, and just to show an example, so South Carolina, in the last census, they appropriated $1 million for the state, and they did get a new seat. So that does make a difference. We are working with some nonprofits as well to try to get regional funding for the Triad region. Because it does make a difference to have a campaign and have a person dedicated to the census. So,
what's the latest on the citizenship question? I think they put that off with the Supreme Court. Did the Supreme Court make a comment on that? Or
yes, it will not be
right
on the form, and we have already started printing those. So,
what was the Supreme Court's comment, though? Didn't somebody say it's okay, but she had to do something or had to be timed a certain way?
I don't remember exactly what the comment was, to be honest with you. But we have to kind of take a pretty neutral stance on it.
I understand.
Just being at the census.
But what the news is what the news is.
Right.
Okay. All right.
Yes.
That's a political answer.
Absolutely. The rules are the rules. We got to find out what the rules are and then make sure we use them the best that we can to our advantage, or at least not to be put at a disadvantage by not knowing them.
Yes.
So, all right, does anybody else have any other questions or comments? Thank you so much
for coming
today.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
And your contact information was on here, so if we have civic groups or anybody in Alamance County who wants to learn more about the census, then they can reach you at your contact information, which is up there on the screen now.
Yes,
and
be great.
You'll be available to talk to groups and
spread
the word.
Absolutely.
The census, though, ask people years ago or something, somebody about whether they had guns in their house or something like that. Wasn't there a social inquiry about your lifestyle?
I think the American Community Survey could ask that question. They're very detailed, that specific.
But the census didn't ask that.
I did not work for them then. So I don't know. But I didn't see the form. But if I was guessing, it would be on that survey.
Okay.
All right. Thank you so much. Okay. Next, we have Stacey Saunders with a Board of Health appointment and then the budget amendment.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So what you have before you is the vacant position on the Board of Health. It's our, by statute, the nurse position. The Board of Health is comprised of 11 members, and by statute, certain ones are by discipline. This is one that's by discipline. In your packet, you have the three applicants with the Board of Health recommendation, which is Mary Elena Castaneda. Questions?
So there's just one?
No, you have, in your packet, you should have three.
I'm only seeing one.
Okay.
There's three. I don't know, I'm not looking online. I'm looking in my papers though.
So there were three applicants to the nurse position.
I don't.
And the Board of Health reviewed all three, actually interviewed all three, reviewed their applications, discussed it as a board, and made a recommendation. Ms. Castaneda actually has applied twice to the Board of Health, one as a public, as a member at large, and then secondly as a nurse position.
If y'all don't have that in front of you, how about if we ask somebody to make a copy of this paper?
Yeah, I'd like to say that.
And then pass them out, hand them out?
Who is going off, Stacy? Is there?
Somebody make that?
We had a nurse, Ms. Tina McGee, who resigned from her position due to some other issues.
Right. Is the vote, do they vote on this, the Board of Health?
The board looks at all the applicants and then makes a recommendation to you all. You all, by statute, are the ones who appoint, so.
Yeah, it's our policy.
That's right.
Sure.
In the past.
We make the decision.
That's right.
Their recommendation was unanimous.
That's correct.
Is that the way it works?
Well, by majority, but if I remember correctly, there was no dissent.
How many people in that?
On the board?
Yeah, the vote.
So typically it's 11 members, but with two missing, it would have been nine.
Nine people.
All right, well, if while we're getting those copies made, how about, would it be out of order to go ahead and do the budget amendment? Can we go ahead and do that?
I don't see why not.
You take it up board if the board agrees.
Thank you, pardon?
If the board is agreeable with that.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, let's do that. You want to go ahead and do the budget amendment?
All right. So also in your packet, you have a budget amendment, which is a budget amendment in theory. I will tell you that you all approved this grant actually last fiscal year, and the state decided to extend the funding period. So that meant we had money at the end of this past fiscal year that could be carried over into this fiscal year. So that's what you're actually seeing. So there's a funding or a budget amendment for this fiscal year because we actually carried more over than we were anticipating because of that extension in the service period. So we received notification of the funding extension for the local mitigation to the opioid crisis funding. And what we're carrying over into this fiscal year is actually $25,374.
I'll move that we accept that.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve that budget amendment. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay.
But does
I should have talked longer.
Yes, you should have. And the opioid and seeing news and stuff, it seems like some things are working in the public that to help that situation and the number of cases.
Right, so we actually have been using this funding. So if you'll remember back in December of 2017, we had that big community leaders forum where we had lots, about 100 folks, leaders within the community come and to talk about the magnitude of the problem. We had the sheriff speak about what it looks like for first responders and for law enforcement. And that group of leaders at that point came up with essentially lots of strategies. And so lots of the community partners who were planning that got back together and said, well, what do we do now? And so we had that follow-up in May of 2018 where we took those strategies and asked the community leaders. At that point, I think it was about 70 of you who came back to prioritize some of those. And we came up with four domains of priority, being policy, prevention and education, treatment and recovery, and harm reduction. And from there, we created that community task force, AC HOPE, which is multidisciplinary. So it's not just the health department. We've got first responders and EMS, mental health providers, community members. I mean, it's quite large. And they're organized in those four domains of work. And so this grant was actually to help push the work of the AC HOPE task force around education and prevention through case review and establishing a team for that,
learning about harm reduction and what that means, and also supporting quick response.
Now, are you keeping, I'm sure you're keeping statistics of the results.
Yes.
Always good to see things happen, but you don't know what the results are.
That's right. So some of it was just to get the group up and running, and so creating some baseline. We do have more of that aggregate data that comes from the state from what's the burden of how many pills are prescribed in Alamance County.
Doctors have changed a lot over the last several years.
That's right, because of legislation that came through.
Good. You can't go to your veterinarian. It's not something about
that. That's right.
Okay, so you have the before you, returning to the agenda item about the Board of Health appointment. You have before you now the three applications for committee membership. One is Mary Elena Castaneda, and then the second is Kathleen DeVore, and then the third is Sarah Rush.
Yes. And so all three were interviewed by the Board of Health, or representatives of the Board of Health for the personal health committee.
Ms. Rush appears to be from the future. The date of her application is 2/21/2019. A long time from now.
I am curious about the one from Duke. What was her? What was her arena? As far as what she did.
Is this?
Is it on there?
Is this Ms. Rush?
I believe so, yes.
I am not, I do not know the answer to that. I wasn't a part of her interview with the Board of Health.
Well, that address, Trent Drive. I spent many a day on that drive. Mm-hmm. So I was just curious what she did. Is there anything else in the bio that might give away to that?
I don't see anything else in there.
Well, since they have already vetted the one that they like, I will make a motion that we
So we have a motion and a second to approve the application of Mary Elena Castaneda for the Board of Health nurse position. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
All right, next on our agenda is to discuss the job descriptions. We first waded into these waters back in May. May 20th, we had a meeting where we talked about the job descriptions in session with the four direct appointees to the board. And some suggestions were made for revision at that time. And then we started working on the budget and some other things, and then summer happened. And so now we are back around to taking a look at that once again. And I think that you have had your, in your packet you had the updated job descriptions. What I did was I went to the tape from May 20th and reviewed the comments that had been made. I incorporated those into the existing job description, and then I emailed that to each of the direct appointees. And the county manager, we'll just start with that one, the first. I think that the main change was adding I don't think we changed the essential functions of the class. Illustrative examples of work. We added develop and review the capital improvement plan for facilities, including the county, Alamance Community College, and the Alamance Burlington School System. And we added coordinate proposed economic development projects, working with the county attorney, the economic development officer, the tax administrator, municipalities as appropriate. And we added monitor approved economic development projects for compliance with incentive contracts. We added provide periodic financial and other reports to the Board of Commissioners and the general public. Bless you. And I think those were all things that were discussed during the meeting. Then two things that I've noticed from looking at county manager job descriptions from other counties that Manager Haygood agreed were good ideas. Valid North Carolina driver's license at the end. He needs to be able to drive.
Yeah.
No substance, no DUIs. Losing your driver's license will cost you a job. And then reside in Alamance County. I've noticed that that was one in another county's job description. I think that's important. Our county commissioner, I mean, county commissioners, that's really important.
Yeah,
the county. For the county.
That's a good idea.
County manager reside in Alamance County. So, and Manager Haggis reviewed those and agreed with them. And so I think if everybody is satisfied with that, then that's good to go. And I don't think we need a vote on these. I think it's just a consensus. So tax administrator did exactly the same thing, emailed, or edited, added things, emailed, and he agreed to, Jeremy agreed to the things. So we added, represents Alamance County at the Property Tax Commission. We added that. That was something that came up. Collaborates with the county manager, attorney, etc., in evaluating proposed economic incentive contracts. We added assists in monitoring approved economic development incentive contracts for compliance. And I think that was all that we added. Is that right, Jeremy?
That's it. I believe so.
That was pretty uncomplicated. So does anybody have any questions or comments about
this? We didn't add that he needs a driver's license.
We did not add that he needs a driver's license.
He may
he
have to go out
himself
and
around.
Get some tax collection.
So, I mean, if y'all wanted to add that, we could certainly.
I think that's pretty important because there are times that you will have to go out
so,
and fill.
All right.
So,
let's do it.
Definitely want him to have a driver's license.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
We don't want to have to hire you a chauffeur.
Yeah, we don't want to
have
might
be better with a chauffeur.
All right. Well, we will make that addition then. Valid North Carolina driver's license. By the way, Manager Haygood has his CDL, I'm told. So if we need to ride a bus anywhere, he's ready. But we're not going to make Jeremy get that, I guess. All right, so then next is the clerk to the board. And if a person goes back and looks at the May 20th meeting, you'll see that we kind of ran out of time to talk to Tori directly in session about her job description. And so she and I met and went over it in kind of detail over the course of two meetings, actually, because we ran out of time for that too. But she and I agreed that she does all this stuff. I mean, if you look at it, it's really long. It's a lot of things that the clerk to the board is responsible for.
And she has to have a lot of stuff.
A lot of stuff.
And she's got to have a valid driver's license and all stuff.
Yep, she does. Possession of a valid North Carolina driver's license. So if anybody has any additions or deletions or anything like that, this would be the time to make them. If not, we can go on to the county attorney. Okay, so I guess that's okay?
Yep.
Everybody's good? Then the county attorney, when I sent him the revisions, he had some things that he came back with that were a little more extensive, or actually a bit more extensive than the things that we had discussed in open session on May 20th. And so I thought they bore weight or carried weight for discussion in open session so that the rest of the board could participate in that discussion. One thing that we did agree on was that the old count, job description included in it serves as the clerk to the Board of Commissioners. That's not true. So we have a clerk to the Board of Commissioners, so that was taken out. We did add in there something about representing the county before the North Carolina Property Tax Commission. That was discussed. I also added the... same items about economic development that were put into the tax administrator and the county attorney's job descriptions. And I believe, as reflected on his, the valid North Carolina driver's license is in there too. So, I don't think that, Mr. Albright, you didn't delete anything that I had added, right?
No, I did not.
Okay, so do you want to explain the things that you had put into your revision?
Sure. The general statement of duties, I refer to the statute 153A114, also mentioning the designation as the legal counsel for the county in matters before the Property Tax Commission, working with my co-counsel behind me here when people appeal their tax values. I also added that we'd have a litigation deputy. I'm sorry, let me start over. We have a paralegal that helps us in our tax foreclosure lawsuits, which is a big part of the reason we've got a 98.9% collection rate. I felt like that was important to put in there as well.
Was there a reason we took out the admitted to practice before the United States District Court, Middle District?
I thought that was in there.
It's not in your revision.
No, well, I am licensed to practice there and for the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals.
Well, I think it's important to distinguish that there's a difference between what you do and your license to do and your qualifications and what a prospective applicant, because it's not really necessary that person applying to be county attorney appear before the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals.
I think we've got two cases that have gone up there. But it's helpful to be admitted to that bar. It's not an essential function of the job. Most counties hire outside counsel to go before the Fourth Circuit because their rules are so complex and you have to drive to Richmond to make your argument, if you have an argument. As far as appearing before the Middle District, that was something I don't think was contemplated when I was offered this job 14 years ago, but we sort of fell into that with all the invitations we've gotten to the Middle District Court at Greensboro. So become sort of an expert at that area of the law, to the extent that we try and get cases dismissed before we incur a lot of expenses.
I did notice that in another county attorney position in another county did have that being admitted to the U.S. District Court for Middle District North Carolina. That's not, you know, an outlier or something like that. So that's why I'd included it in that revision. And also, Mr. Albright and I talked about that before, you know.
Some of the larger counties surrounding us have seven to ten deputy county attorneys in each of them specializes in that kind of area. But most county attorneys that are in those counties also have experience in federal court, which is important in order to evaluate cases.
Yeah, I would agree that it's important that the job description include that, or the special requirement include that our county attorney be admitted to practice law before the U.S. District Court, the Middle District of North Carolina. What about the next sentence in general statement of duties? The county attorney provides professional legal advice to the county board of commissioners. I think we all agree on that. And the county departments and officials of the county, including the sheriff's department.
Yes.
the county attorney supervises legal department staff, as well as outside counsel defending the county, its departments, and officials. You added the, including the sheriff's department, I believe, and you added supervisors.
Right. Currently, we have two outside firms representing the county, one in the opioid litigation, and the other in our litigation brought against us, once a traffic accident. There are a couple of other cases in federal court, traffic accidents in Superior Court here in Alamance County.
But you don't supervise the outside counsel, like with the opioid lawsuit. We're, as the Board of Commissioners, we can contract directly with outside counsel ourselves without them being supervised or reporting to you. Well, they report to us.
I have assisted them in the gathering of information with the help of our health department and provided that information to them. So to that extent, I would say maybe cooperate with. But when it comes to deciding what path you're going to take in litigation, as far as supervision goes, whether we're going to recommend immediate settlement or whether we're going to fight is a decision that my department makes on the advice of the board. And we've done that several times when we determined that we should hold out and not settle the case in those occasions. Maybe that's not the best word to use. Maybe we should say cooperate with.
I think cooperate is fine. I think we all have an expectation that everybody in the county, in county government, county administration cooperates, coordinates, collaborates with everybody else. But when it comes to a supervisory structure or a reporting structure, I think that flexibility is optimal and that the board wants to be able to do what it wants when it wants to and not be constrained by any kind of rigid view of who reports to who, other than we're the ones that are elected by the citizens to implement policy.
No, I think the general statute cited at the beginning of that covers that.
Right.
Legal advisor to the board.
Well, I think that isn't it obvious that the county attorney supervises legal department staff? I mean, I don't know whether that needs to be stated. Well,
that takes some skill in some situations.
So, the county attorney supervises legal department staff.
I only have two. And they don't require much supervision, but in the past I've had some that required a little extra.
Can we say the county attorney supervises legal department staff and coordinates with outside counsel?
That's fine.
Yeah, I think that'd be better.
Outside counsel defending the county. Okay. All right, then what else? What else did you change?
I don't know if I've made any changes to the illustrative examples of work.
Well, I believe you added a supervision thing and essential functions of the class. Let's see, seventh line down, the county attorney's office represents and defends the Board of County Commissioners, officials, and all county-related employees in the absence of a conflict, either in person or through supervision of outside counsel. You added that word supervision again.
I'm going to change that to cooperation.
Okay. Cooperation with? Okay. The county attorney attends all Board of County Commissioner meetings. The county attorney must exercise considerable independent judgment initiative of all areas of work. There was one county, and this is new for me to bring this up, but there was one county that requires its county attorney to be available 24/7. And is that something that this board wants to address?
I think that's Union County you're referring to. They've experienced explosive growth.
Mm-hmm.
And they've added, I think, 14 positions since I became attorney in the last 10 years.
14 positions?
I mean, they've just exploded in growth. They're just outside of Charlotte. So if people don't want to live in Charlotte,
yes, I've talked to Richard Helms, who's either the chair now or has been in their chair in the past. He's really a nice man.
What was his thoughts on?
I didn't speak to him about this particularly. Okay. I've just talked to him in general when I had other questions. Actually, it's Catawba County.
It's Catawba.
Mm-hmm. And this is the job description for the county attorney. Be available for phone consultation 24/7.
Hmm. Well, I know the sheriff has needs that crop up 24 hours a day, don't you, Sheriff? I'm sure probably the health department might. Stacy's gone, but she might. DSS could.
The only 24-hour need I can remember with the sheriff's department is a search warrant, which I was able to advise the deputy that he needed to get an additional warrant.
And also, according to his job description, which has a date of September 5th, 2018, Catawba County has the same size legal staff that we do. The county attorney supervises two people, an assistant county attorney and a paralegal.
I know Deborah Beckel.
Well, y'all are jumping in. It doesn't sound like you're
going to. I think 24/7 might be something we might need to insert.
Right.
I know the sheriff would need him, and
we would rather stay out of trouble and be able to call you, get in trouble with you, than not
just have the sheriff
get in trouble by ourselves.
He can install a bat phone in my office like he has in
there. All right, we got you covered.
Would you work that like in a medical office where if he was out?
That's really important to 24/7.
Well, generally in those cases, you have several numbers.
Right, and you have an assistant down there too that we should be able to contact. Should you not be able to.
Right.
Mr. Sutton, do you have any thoughts about that?
I think silly to be talking about it. It'd be awesome. Of course, he ought to be available if it was qualified for emergencies or, my God, they ran a presidential. Who's going to answer the phone at 3 in the morning, who do you want to answer the telephone?
Yeah.
Remember that?
Yeah, I remember that.
Generally,
it didn't happen and they couldn't get her.
By the time I hear about it, it's already happened and they've cleaned up the wreck and they've hauled up the car. So,
people would have to use discretion as to whether. Now, my brother texted me the other night at 1:30 in the morning, Wake Forest had won.
I think we all have that friend.
Like I could care about that.
Yes, I think we all have that friend.
I rolled over and I saw it. He had a long message about Wake beating Utah State. Whoopie-doo.
There you go.
Okay, so then illustrative exams. So I guess we'll add that. Be available for phone. Seems like there's consensus with that. Recommends county policy, procedures, and actions based on legal knowledge and experience. Does anybody have anything to say about that? Or any of the rest of it? There's something else. There's represents Alamance County in litigation and supervises outside counsel. That supervises has been put back in there again. Can we change that to cooperates with?
Yeah.
As we did the two times previous.
Where are you now?
Down under illustrative examples of work.
Yeah, okay.
Then represents Alamance County proceedings before the North Carolina Property Tax Commission. I think that's my addition in my draft, and then Mr. Albright's put that up in the second sentence. The county attorney is designated as the county's legal counsel for property tax appeals for the North Carolina Property Tax Commission. So I'd suggest that we delete that one as being redundant. If you a scan through and see if anything else jumps out at you as being important. One thing that I noticed that Mr. Albright had deleted from his draft is knowledge of the Roberts Rules of Order. Is there a reason that you took that out?
We don't, I don't think we use Roberts Rules of Order because this board is so small. I think we've discussed that before. The only time it's ever come up is a point of order. I think that's the only time. So, Mr. Sutton.
Yeah, we're trying to quiet him.
So,
Lord help him.
It's a good.
That's why we don't do Roberts Rules of Order, right?
It's good for large bodies, yeah. But for bodies that's small, it really is not workable. That's why I think that.
Okay, if y'all agree with that, that's fine with me.
Yeah, I'm in favor of that.
Bill, they were after you too, weren't they?
I think so. That's when I could talk.
Oh, my Lord.
And then we have the outside counsel is inserted again. Is that? Yeah, ability to direct and evaluate the work of subordinate personnel and outside counsel performing legal and paralegal functions. That outside counsel has been added.
Right.
Shall we just delete that and go on with the original wording of that?
Just take the outside counsel out.
Right. Because I don't think we envision him always, or our county attorney always being in a position to evaluate the work of our outside counsel.
Only when they submit a bill.
There you go.
And it's too high. Then I evaluate it and ask them to submit another bill. And that's happened.
Okay, and then under essential knowledge, skills, and abilities, we have ability to communicate effectively with the press, citizens, and officials. Mr. Albright added the press, which I think is good, but he deleted in oral and written form. Is there a reason that you deleted that?
I deleted what? I'm sorry.
In oral and written form. I think it's the last line before minimum experience and training.
You're looking at essential knowledge, skills.
Yes, the last item under essential
ability,
knowledge, skills, and abilities.
Ability to communicate effectively, press, citizens, employees.
Well, I don't know why I left that out, but it's not a problem to put back out.
Okay.
I think I was in a hurry.
So you're going to put that back in?
Sure, that'd
yes.
be fine.
Okay.
And then under minimum experience and training, the board has decided to add the admitted to practice before the U.S. District Court. Okay. I think that I would like to return to the general statement of duties for a moment and just get the board's input on one thing. The sentence, the fourth line down, the sentence starting, the county attorney with the assistance of a deputy county attorney and full-time paralegal provides professional legal advice to the board and the departments and officials of the county, including the sheriff's department. Mr. Albright, you added that, including the sheriff's department,
yes.
to this draft. Can you explain that?
That's been my duty since I walked in the door here.
I think we need to keep it too.
Well, I'm not suggesting that would change, but why put it in your job description? Why isolate that sheriff's department? Isn't that included in the county departments and officials of the county? Why does that need to be drawn out?
Because that department, by its very nature, draws a lot of litigation.
Well, I don't have any questions.
Sorry,
my goodness, I mean, you know, in budget session, we had the sheriff's department wanting their own attorney. So, you know, I don't see, obviously, I mean, I think that should be highlighted.
Okay. Well, if you agree with that, then that is good enough for me.
Well, don't believe everything I say there.
I'll remind you said that sometime. All right. Is there anything else that needs to be addressed in the job descriptions? If not, thank you very much for your patience with that. I put a lot of energy into this project, and I appreciate the board taking the time and session to go over those things. Mr. Albright, do any of the four people we've been talking about, y'all got any problems, questions, concerns, anything you want to talk about?
No, I don't.
Okay, great. All right, that being said. I'm going to take a moment of personal privilege to recognize our, even though he's not on the agenda and it's unusual, recognize the Register of Deeds, Mr. Hugh Webster is here, and he would like to address the board, and we'd love to hear from you.
First of all, very pleasant, I hope, subject. Each of you commissioners are invited to a sit-down lunch, which will be catered Thursday between 12 o'clock, I mean between 11 o'clock and 1 o'clock. I'm going to spread it over 2 hours because my health needs to wait on customers. So I hope that y'all can make it. It'll be served, it'll be catered by a restaurant here in Alamance County.
And that's at your office?
Yes, at the Register of Deeds office. Yes.
This week?
Thursday.
The 5th. All right.
I would like to get some idea who will be there.
I'll be there.
I'm not sure of you. I think
I'm going to be in Raleigh all day Thursday. So
bless your heart. But that's my team. I think
if I'm not, I'll be there.
Okay.
Tomorrow.
Well, if I get qualified, it'd be good. But anyway, I hope you can come. I mean, the purpose of this is a sit-down lunch. And there will be no takeout. It'll be 2 meats and 4 vegetables and fresh made peach cobbler and tea and lemonade.
That sounds good to me.
Very nice. And, thank you.
That sounds like
so. I wanted to make sure that y'all got the message. I didn't know if you got the memo or not.
I hadn't seen anything about it before.
I never saw it.
Well, you know, sometimes you don't completely depend upon help to do what they're supposed to do. Okay.
That it?
Anyway, it'll be sit down. There won't be any takeout.
Great. And, thank you.
The purpose of it is I'm feeding my help, and this is Hugh Webster feeding his help. So expression of appreciation for the best help I've ever had.
Well, good for you.
Thank you, Hugh.
Yep.
Anyway, I want to say something else too. I was drafted, conscripted into the military during the Vietnam fiasco. And those of us who were too poor and didn't have the political clout to dodge the draft were the ones who got drafted. And I'm very sorry that I got caught up in that. And then we had a saying in the Army. And I will tell you that I thought, growing up on the farm, working on the farm, I thought I knew dummies. But when I went into the Army, I found out, I saw a new high in dummies. But the saying was, if it ain't broke, fix it until it is.
Well, that's the kind of thing.
And that meant, what it means, and that was a vernacular. It means if it's not broken, I'll put that in proper English, if it's not broken, fix it until it is broken. And that's what happened to us a lot in the Army. And what I see, and by the way, I'm having eye surgery pretty soon. I can't talk, I can't walk, and I can't see. And getting old, ain't always cracked up to that. But I'm trying to make it until December the 31st of 2020. But Graham, City Council, I don't know where in the hell these voters got these idiots from.
Mr. Webster.
What a bunch of idiots.
Mr. Webster, I'm going to
interrupt. If the Graham City Council goes along with that, they shouldn't be voted out of office, wouldn't they?
Mr.
That's
Webster.
That's for sure.
And Mr.
Put that down, too.
Mr. Webster, I'm going to move on with our agenda now.
Go ahead.
Thank you for coming, and thank you for your invitation to lunch. I look forward to it. I'm glad to see you.
By the way, my people are instructed not to harass or pound or harangue y'all. You can ask everything you want to, but I'm supposed to ask you this.
Yes, sir. I've been to your office a few times, and I've never been harassed, hounded, or harangued. Not yet. So, Cheryl Marley, she's a treasure. Cheryl Marley is a treasure over there. She's a good lady. All right, so we're going to move on in our agenda to our non-agenda item related public speakers. The first one signed up to speak is Ron Spinopen.
Ron, welcome.
Thank you, and good morning. I'm a resident of Snow Camp, and I am speaking to you this morning on behalf of my neighbor, Stephanie Thurman. She is unable to attend in person today, and also on behalf of our Snow Camp community. During the last commissioner's meeting, I bore witness to Mrs. Thurman's sharing with you her problems with a Hydro permitted solar farm on Snow Camp Road, adjacent to her property. To refresh your memories, storm water released during the construction of that solar farm damaged her property, and the vegetative buffer along her property line was never installed as required under the HIDO. You may not have been aware that Mrs. Thurman has been requesting help from the County Planning Department to resolve these issues since 2016. This is 3 years of no resolution to the problems. In 2016, Mrs. Thurman sent an email to Robert Key, Director of Inspections, asking, have all regulations with regard to distance from the property lines, distance from streams and waterways been upheld? And who in Alamance County is responsible for looking out for me to make sure they have not infringed my rights as a property owner? Mr. Key's response, we are very interested in protecting the property owners. Our office does this primarily through enforcement of the North Carolina Building Code. Some property issues are legal in nature and may require assistance from an attorney. I heard the same option repeated in your last meeting when Commissioner Chair Gailey stated that Mrs. Thurman has the opportunity to hire an attorney and sue the solar farm as a remedy for the damages that their construction has caused to her property. My point is this. I don't think that the citizens of Alamance County having to file lawsuits is an acceptable way to enforce our county's ordinances, and in particular permitted land use. If we don't have sufficient county personnel to enforce our laws, then we need to budget for and hire the necessary staffing to do so. If citizens must file lawsuits to protect their rights, then that is going to be a huge deterrent not only to expanding the population of Alamance County, but retaining our current residents as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Gary
Olickney. Okay. That has his hand up.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Gary Ulickney, and I reside in Snow Camp, North Carolina. I've not been here as frequently as my colleagues because I've been working more closely with the State Mining Office in the review of the mining permit application by Alamance Aggregates. One thing that I've heard fairly often here at the county commissioner meetings is that the NC State permit and the county permit are interdependent, and that approval of one is related to approval of the other. We want you to note it's totally incorrect, as they are totally separate processes. We recently asked Judy Wehner, the state mining specialist with the DEQ, specifically if the state permitting process would be impacted if the county hydro permit were found to be invalid, and she answered no. The county permit has no bearing on the state's mining permit process, nor is it required for state approval. So if you're thinking that somehow the state is going to intervene in our nightmare situation by denying the state permit, we are mistaken. The state is not in the business of denying permits. When applications of the state are deficient, they simply ask for deficient information again, again, and again, which creates an endless cycle of repeat submissions that can go on for years. We need to rely on our own good sense and the statutes in our hydro to resolve the controversy with the county permit issued to C. Wayne McDonald that contains clear evidence of violations. If you look at your handouts, it is clear that the site plan submitted to the state is very different from the one submitted to the county for the hydro permit. Among other things, there are several highlighted streams on the state site plan that do not show up on the county map, including one indicated with an arrow that actually originates in the mining site. These streams do not appear on the county site plan whatsoever, despite the fact that the hydro requires that the site plan show locations of any streams, ponds, or other waterways on the property. Class 4 industries are required under hydro to maintain a minimum stream setback for the operational area of 100 feet from any perennial or intermittent stream. It is questionable how this requirement could be met for these undisclosed streams, particularly the one that originates directly in the mine site. These are just some of the violations of the heavy industry ordinance that we have notified the county of in July 1st, 2019 letter from our attorney. My understanding is that an ordinance is a law. When laws are broken, there needs to be some consequence. Otherwise, an ordinance is nothing more than a mere suggestion. I ask you on behalf of our community how you plan to address the notice of violations expressed in our letter. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ulickney. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Donna Poe. As you know, I frequently speak on behalf of many in our community of Snow Camp, expressing our fears and concerns regarding a hydro permit issued by the county to Mr. C. Wayne McDonald for a blast quarry in our neighborhood. I also account for the outcome of the commissioners' meetings to our community. And I am at a loss, quite frankly, as to how to explain to them why, after you instructed the county attorney to respond to our attorney's letter detailing the hydro violations in Mr. McDonald's application a month ago, he has yet to do so. It is increasingly difficult to explain his non-response, considering he speaks frequently about conversations that he has with the attorney for the mining company. Yet he seems reluctant to reach out to the attorney who is representing voting citizens of Alamance County. Our attorney's July 1st letter details what we see as violations of the hydro caused by inaccuracies in the site plan, and to be clear, is not questioning the procedure that was followed in issuing the hydro permit. Violations are actions that are not in compliance with the ordinance, which is essentially a law. We are stating clear violations of a law. We believe that it is the county's responsibility to enforce its ordinances. But in that there has been such a delay in your responding to our complaint of violations, I am thinking the cited violations may only be clear to us. Records show that this is the first Class 4 hydro permit ever issued in this county under any land use ordinance. As it is not a familiar process, there could be confusion regarding the county's requirements under the ordinance and the questions surrounding of the permit review by the Planning Department Director, who unfortunately left her position here after approving the permit and before any public notice of its approval. Assuming that confusion might be the reason for the lack of response to our complaint, would it be possible for the commissioners to enlist the services of an external independent attorney, an expert in land use law, who might expeditiously, like within 30 days, review with our attorney the HIDO violations outlined in his letter, make a fair and accurate evaluation, and provide a legal opinion. We are open to any suggestion on how we can initiate a review of the violations detailed in our attorney's letter without having to go to court. Our community just finds it unacceptable that we would have to file lawsuits to enforce our ordinances. Thank you very much for your consideration, and to God be the glory in this process.
This guy was the last public speaker. Before I open to the board for other people to comment, I want to address Mr. Spinoven's remarks about the things that I said at the last meeting about using a private attorney to address a situation with a neighbor. So I can see how that would be confusing, that it sounded like instead of enforcing, that we would be telling people no, instead of the county doing its job, you have to go hire a private attorney to do the job that the county should be doing. But as I see it, there's a difference in role and in remedy. So if I own a piece of property and I have a neighbor who's doing something with their property and there's an ordinance against that and it's causing damage to my property, I can call the county or the governing authority and complain and make them do something, put up a fence or somehow address it. But that doesn't clean up what's happened with my property. So if I have lost, say, the use of a pond because of runoff or pollution or something like that, the governing authority would be able to put up a barrier or something like that. But as far as the original harm to my land, the county can't, or the governing authority can't, as far as I understand it, force the company to do something to set me back whole again. That's what the private attorney would be for. And sometimes if a private attorney is effective in getting the damage taken care of, that can be a more effective way or useful way to get the neighbor to stop doing what it is, whatever it is that's bothering me to start with. So I can see how that's confusing. That seems like you're mixing a lot of apples and oranges together, but really the ordinances are there to put certain structures or things in place. Private law is there to remedy and to provide damages to people who've been harmed. So that would be my explanation for that, because that is confusing, and I'm glad that you brought that up.
Can I respond to that?
No, you can't. You can come back in 2 weeks and respond. So, now, having said that, turn the discussion over to the rest of the board for anything that y'all want to say.
He did mention the fact that we are hiring an extra person in planning. Is that not true?
Yes, that's correct.
And, of course, we've only had one planning director per se.
That's right.
So,
well, this?
Yeah, go ahead and see.
Okay. This has come up a lot, and I think we really need to figure out what's going on here. If this, you know, you got two different maps. One map shows water that the other one doesn't show. The one that we apparently were reviewing, am I correct, Clyde? This is the one that was reviewed for the original permit?
I'd have to look at it. I haven't brought a copy of that one, but in our closed session meeting, we went over all the
right.
Final maps. I'm going to have a magnifying glass to read this, but we have looked at our maps, and the final maps meet all the requirements of the HIDO.
What is the final map for the county is different from the one that is submitted to the state?
I have no idea what the state required them to do. The state has other issues with streams and water quality.
Yeah, the Division of Water Quality is a lot tougher than what we would ever look at. So.
But if it's a stream, it's a stream. I'm not really understanding why some streams should be shown on a state map and not be shown on a county map.
They met the requirements of our ordinance. What I'm saying is I don't know what the state law requires the mining commission to do. Maybe they're more stringent.
Stringent on what? Defining a stream?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. The water quality.
The state has many ways of defining a stream. And the federal government has many ways of defining a navigable stream, which is another issue for another day. But the definitions that govern those boards are what they're talking about. We used our rule, which we are in the process of amending.
Do you happen to know what's our definition of a stream? How do we?
Not offhand, I'd have to look it up. The planning director right now, she's around.
No, she's definitely not in here. I don't think there's anybody in the overflow room.
Well, I mean, our job as elected officials is to try and do what's right for our citizens, I think, and this just keeps coming up as a question. We've got to arrive at a decision that says it's right or it's wrong. We get input from our people, we get input from outside people. I have asked the county manager to take a look at an unassociated third party that might be qualified to take a look at this and evaluate it. As I understand what I'm looking at here, you're not asking about the permit process, you're asking about violations. I would venture the same people that we would look at for the permit process could look at it from during the planning with another cog. They could look at this from a violations perspective as well, correct?
I'm sure, yes.
I'd like to see us look at engaging, and I'll make a motion that we engage a third party agency to take a look at this and determine if the violations are effective or not.
Well, I'll say that by our rules that we adopted, the rules for the procedure of the board, motions are out of order and commissioner responses and public comment time. That we agreed as a board in, I believe, early 2017 to only consider motions for agenda items that have been duly calendared. However, that being said, the planning department is supervised by the county attorney, right?
By the county manager?
I mean the county manager.
Yes, that's correct.
Sorry.
it takes a lot of work from legal and county manager in the planning department world, yes.
But so the planning department is supervised and managed by the county manager.
That's correct.
And you have authority to spend money, right, up to a certain amount to get outside help, is that right?
That's correct.
What's the limit on that? No?
I think I can enter into contract per my authorization up to $50,000.
And as a matter of fact, you have in the past gotten outside help to look at certain functions of county government when you've had questions about them in the past.
Yes, that's correct. Right?
Do you have any examples of that?
I think probably the most recent was CECOM. We had the call on Dorset Street that caused some concern. We wanted to make sure with an impartial group come in and look at how we handled that call and review our processes, and CECOM is very helpful. Helped us come up with a number of recommendations that we've implemented, almost all of them now. That's probably the most recent thing I can think of.
That was the man with the machete?
Yes.
Machete man?
Yes. That is correct.
Unfortunate situation. So there is precedence for the county manager to call in outside experts to review the performance of people under his administration. So,
may I interject something here? The key in this case is the vested rights of the property owner that's developing the quarry. North Carolina case law is pretty clear as to those rights. Our HIDO permit does not envision allowing someone to come in when we've turned a permit down. We've turned a permit down for a heavy industry. And just this morning, the attorney for that industry is complaining about it. If you start down the precedent of hiring third parties to review planning director decisions, where will it end? If this permit is denied, and it has been because of the moratorium, are we going to also have someone look at that decision? And I think you just open yourself up to a lawsuit in this case. That's the law. It's the black letter law in this state. With the statute that was just passed in July, not only will you get to pay the attorney's fees for the county, you get to pay them for the other side. It takes it completely out of the discretion of trial court. It says you shall pay the other side's attorney's fees. It's very dangerous.
Would it be more appropriate or possible to start this conversation by maybe having the planning director come in and give a presentation at the next commissioner's meeting? And could the planning director touch on the points that the Snow Camp Mine attorney has made here in public and explain why? Because my understanding is the documents that we have, the plans that we have all met the terms of our ordinance and meet all of our requirements. And it sounds like this attorney has said they don't, that the documentation that they've seen do not. I mean, can you even do that? Would that even be allowable to have Tanya come and say, here's why this permit, in our opinion, from county government's opinion, is good, and why this information that you've received in this letter from this attorney is not correct? And can you start it there?
We did that in closed session in great detail.
Well, the question here doesn't appear to be, though, as much about the permitting process as it is about a violation.
Now, they haven't violated anything as of yet because they're not in business.
Well, I guess my question was, for the benefit of the residents, is there value in doing it in open session, or is that even possible? Just because we have so many folks that continue to doubt the validity of the permit. It sounds like it was discussed with the board, but
question is the validity of the permit. It's not a violation yet. They haven't even opened or done anything. Now, they may be in violation of what they submitted. We don't know that for sure.
And you won't get that, Mr. Boswell, until they actually build the buildings and set the equipment.
You can't violate something unless you've done that.
I have a question. Is possession of a county permit a requirement to begin the application process with the State Mining Commission?
Yes, I think so.
The local jurisdiction.
Local jurisdiction.
Started, right?
Then it goes to the state. And if there are any federal laws that have to be reviewed, I guess the state will bring those to play.
Because I understand that that's not correct.
That's my understanding of the way it works. I've never done a rock quarry or any asphalt plant or anything like this. But that is my understanding.
I would ask that you find the answer to that in a definitive term.
Okay.
See.
Do you have any thoughts?
I think what Andy's saying is what we need to do. Find out.
Find out if that's a requirement for the state?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You got to answer one question at a time, it looks like. So
that's right. That's legally.
Mr. Sutton, do you have any thoughts about that?
Yeah, the ultimate third party would be a judge, but to avoid getting the bill for that, I don't have a problem with what Steve's saying, and I think three people on this board could overrule, if I'm not mistaken, push forward his motion, number one. Number two, do we know whether or not the state would hold up their process while this was going on?
Do not know the answer to that question. I can find out that too.
And with the group here, is the state getting everything you're showing us and so forth?
Yes, sir.
Good. And last question. It shouldn't be taboo for me to ask a question, no matter which side of the fence I'm sitting on or what seat I'm sitting on. Do we know whether Ms. Hodges has been deposed or not?
I don't know the answer to that question. I haven't heard anything about her since she left, so I don't know. By the state, you mean, as part of the...
Well, by somebody. I mean, who, legal on their side, or do you know?
No. I haven't spoken with her.
I don't think she has because there's not been a lawsuit filed yet.
Okay.
Generally, you have to have that.
Well, she could be asked questions a lot.
But you can take discovery-type depositions before you file a lawsuit, but I just don't know if that's happening.
See, I'm not going to lie to you. I called down to South Carolina. I mean, the truth is, the truth shouldn't hurt nobody. Except in a divorce case. No, seriously. I called down there to South Carolina where she was and left a message a couple of times. And I got a phone call back from their office, but no message and hung up. And then when I tried to call back, but I was going to do my good way of trying to ask questions myself about. Because I've said it over and I mean it. It's hard for me to believe that she sat in that position by herself and did this without talking to somebody other than her. I mean that. Whether it be the county manager, whether it be the county attorney, I just can't believe it didn't take place. And that's part of what I want to know about.
Sure.
And so if I thought the state would the Institute of Government have anybody in their legal arena that would intervene here or at least review here?
Well, they wouldn't intervene.
No, and I said review.
But I mean, you could ask for they have
mediation.
A block, so you can ask for comment on it. But the black letter law is it's a prospective economic advantage.
Yeah.
And to interfere with that would constitute a civil wrong. That's horrible. And there's recent case law from the Court of Appeals on that very issue. That's why it's dangerous to proceed down that path. That's why I'm advising against it.
And I don't respect your advice. Well, can we find out whether the state would hold up on a third party? Look.
Sure.
I'll ask that question.
Yeah.
Anybody else? I'm not looking to cut anybody's thoughts off or stifle debate or anything like that.
Can we get a summary of where we're going? Because I've been trying to follow this conversation. I'm not sure where we wound up.
Well, my task is to contact the State Mining Commission to inquire as to whether a local jurisdiction permit is a prerequisite before the Mining Commission looks at their permit. And the second is, will the State Mining Commission delay or toll its permit review process if a lawsuit is filed?
I think we were lukewarm to Mr. Haga's suggestion about having a presentation by the planning director.
I think that's a good start, and Clyde, of course, will have his answers by then.
So you think that we should have a presentation?
So what I was talking about was taking the
process, basically, of what happened.
I don't see any harm in it. What do you think, Clyde?
What we're talking about is taking the attorney's letter that they sent and having Tanya go through and explain how we are okay. But if we, you know, I don't know what the legal fallout from that could be, but it just seems like the board is hearing from us that we've handled this correctly. We've met all the terms of the ordinance. I think the folks that live there, they're continuing to doubt that. Is there any value, or is it even possible, or does it put the county in some kind of compromised legal position if Tanya comes and specifically touches on those items in the attorney's letter? I don't know if that's...
I think it's a dangerous precedent. If you start down that path, we also have environmental health inspectors in this county. What if I get a bad grade at my restaurant and I want a third party to come in and show why I shouldn't have gotten it? What if the sheriff's deputy arrests me and I don't think he should have? And I want a third party to come in.
Well, I guess I would be talking about Tanya herself coming, not no third party. This would be Tanya coming for a presentation before the public and the board saying, here are the problems that the attorney for No Snow Camp Mine has pointed out is wrong with the permit. These are the reasons why that is not accurate. Is it not, no third party, we're talking about Tanya coming and pointing those reasons out. It, again, I don't know if that's okay to do, but my understanding is we are in good standing with our process. The final plat has been received and is good. All our paperwork is in order. The information that is in the No Snow Camp Mine attorney's letter is not the final word. We have the final word, and it's good. That's my take on this. That's what I'm hearing. So could Tanya, not a third party, come and reiterate that to the board? Understanding that Tanya wasn't here when the review process was done. None of the planning department staff were working in planning when this came through the planning department. So, and Todd, I would certainly say, I don't know how that, Tanya come in addressing those points, if that does something legally, that would be bad for the county. I don't know. No third party planner, planning director doing
I think it's basically a review of the policy that was in place at that time, and go down the list and just explain it to us, because we weren't involved in that process. I mean, it could be a hypothetical, let's just go over this total process and talk about it, as opposed to even putting
Well, I think the Snow Camp Mine attorney, how does that work? The Snow Camp Mine folks have raised, what I've seen, specific points about why we failed to do our job, right? So is it okay for us to say publicly, This is we did it correctly, and here's the proof.
Right,
from our own perspective, no third party, from county staff perspective.
Why would we not have had this map instead of this map when we were doing the approval?
Because we're not Division of Water Quality. I can speak to that from the development side. When a developer goes to develop property, these are the rules they're going to go by. There at one time they were pushing that to be a source of water,
right?
But when you see the streams on here, they're taking different perspectives on that.
As I said, they're different rules. Yes. I can look at walking that tightrope. We could probably find a way to do what we discussed in our closed session meeting, where we went over each and every question. I know Mr. Sutton wasn't at that meeting, so maybe it'd be a good thing to do.
Yeah, that's true.
That feels better.
Memo first to the board and decide if they want to discuss it properly.
I just wanted to respond to you saying setting a dangerous precedent that somebody who's been arrested could come back and ask for an independent review, or somebody who has, with the health department, come back and ask for an independent review. There's a couple of distinctions with that. One, when a person is arrested, there is an independent review. It's called the criminal justice system.
Right.
They review all of that and make sure that if you have the sheriff's office or law enforcement does not operate independent of scrutiny by any stretch of the imagination. Second, that you're talking about individuals versus a group or a community or a large group of people. With the permit, you're talking about a lot of people who've been affected, versus your examples were more one-on-one interactions with staff people on a daily basis. The HIDO is not a daily occurrence, thankfully. I think that would be an important distinction, that we're not opening the door to any time somebody is aggrieved by county policy, then we're going to hire an expert to look into it. But I certainly do hope that anybody who is aggrieved by action by a county employee would feel that their concerns have been received seriously, and that we are receptive and open to hearing about the impacts of county decisions on people's lives. You know, we're not slamming the door in people's faces saying, county staff has decided, go home, we don't want to hear from you anymore. That should never be the posture of a local government. And I'm not that's kind of a hyperbole on what you're saying. I'm not saying that that is, you know, exactly what you're saying the county government should do by any stretch. But I think it's very dangerous not to question our people. The county staff would operate on a high hill and be unchallengeable. Thank you. I don't know why I'm grasping so much for vocabulary today. I think that county staff should know that when they acted, they're could be questioned on their actions, and the CCOM example is a very good one of that. That was an organization in county government that some things happened, and there were some results, and an expert took a look at how do we do things better. I also want to say, though, that with respect to having Tanya come to tell us about the process of the permit and how it works, there is one point of value in that we haven't talked about, and that's the moratorium and the revision of the HIDO that's ongoing. And the crux of the issue with revising the HIDO has to do with whether or not the county is going to use setbacks for how the property is going to be developed, or whether we're going to use The other thing, we have a 2,000 feet out from the center of operations, a buffer, thank you. Are we going to use setbacks or are we going to use buffers? And that's really a core consideration for the heavy industrial development ordinance. And so I think that through walking us through this permit process, that will help us to understand that problem a little bit better.
And how to go forward to fix the problems. Yes.
Yeah, I think that in walking through how this permit was done, we can get educated in how we need to revise the ordinance and make it a stronger and better ordinance.
What's your thoughts, Clyde?
Well, you received, each one of you, an email over the holiday from someone who's upset because we won't grant them a permit for a heavy industry. And they want to meet this week to second guess the planning director who said no. But I'll just throw that out there. This is the type of door that you'll open if you don't have the confidence in your staff. Or don't show the confidence in your planning stuff.
Well, I'll say from experience, sometimes citizen review of government is not a bad thing.
That's true. But the danger is once the permit has been issued,
right,
and the developer has spent hundreds of thousands of dollars relying on that permit, that's the danger you face here.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think we've agreed that we'd like to have the planning director walk us through how this permit was done. And we've agreed that we would like the county attorney to research a couple of questions for us.
And maybe have her explain the two different maps that we received today as to what the state requires versus what we require.
And in fact, if it's, unless county attorney says that this is not legally advisable and the board agrees, I thought it was to ask the planning director to touch on these points that have been raised in the attorney's letter to the board, say these are the reasons why you failed the county, and have her address them and say, no, that's not the case. We have that document. They may be looking at a different document, but here it is in my hand, the one that says we're good to go. And again, I understand the concern about maintaining a level of confidence in the staff. This is a strange situation where all the staff are no longer with us. It's, Tanya has kind of inherited this at planning, came in after a permit was issued and everything has been done. I think she's done a fine job. I don't have any reason to doubt her take on this. I think it just would be helpful for the board and for the citizens to hear us say, this is why let us demonstrate why we are saying we did this correctly. So.
I think that's a good point, because sometimes people can take questions or concerns as criticism and be defensive, but it's very much an opportunity to show your stuff and to demonstrate how knowledgeable and capable you are.
Sir,
she's got some homework to do.
But I think that as far as maybe the details of what she'll say in that presentation, that can be worked out by her and you and Clyde.
Yes.
Okay. Is there anything else?
Is there a consensus with us five?
I think so.
Yeah, I'm going to be honest with you. How long is the original ordinance that Libby operated under? How long is that?
I believe that was 2011, that the HIDO that's in place right now is.
Yeah, it became effective 2011.
How many pages? How long?
17 pages with attachments. It might be 29. It's not very.
I'm going to be honest with you. I'm sure you've provided it, but can I get it again?
Of course.
Can I see it?
Send it to all.
You know, in our government, in this country, somebody's ox gets gored, no matter if you sift through the process, somebody's ox gets gored, whether it be the ox owner or the ox rider or buyer or whatever. I mean, I'm not trying to protect the county in the least as far as getting the truth out there, as far as monetary charges, so on. And I know that might just come out of the blue, but you know, I support anything we could do to get this thing aired out 100% plus.
Well, exactly.
Such thing as plus,
right.
But 100%.
Certainly.
Absolutely, Mr. Sutton. I completely agree. What's right is right, and we need to focus on doing what's right, and not what's cheapest or safest sometimes.
We plan to do that on September 16th. That'd be the target. Okay.
Okay, so that's the commissioner responses for that, and I just remember something I need to say in my comp in just a second, but do you have a financial report or another report for us?
There is a financial report for July of 2019 attached in your packet. You can take a look at that and let me know if you have any questions. It covers information for the county, the school system, and community college. The only point I wanted to remind the board about was we do have a joint meeting with the Board of Education tomorrow at 10 a.m. over across the street at the county annex. So we'll have Mr. Kenneth Briggs, who will be here. The only topic on the agenda that's official is his presentation and talk about capital project management. It'll be a great chance for the commissioners and the Board of Ed to ask questions about. We've asked Mr. Briggs to really focus and talk a lot about the county's plan, and but we have invited representatives from the cities too. I think we'll have a pretty good attendance. We've heard back from several cities that will come. Because, you know, lots of folks here have capital projects in the mix, so it'll be good for them to come and hear Mr. Briggs. So I look forward to it. I think you'll have a chance to ask lots of questions of an expert. So
who's he with or from?
He was with the North Carolina Community College group. He oversaw capital projects throughout the community college system. I think he also worked at
Asheville.
He's been with the UNC system too, and he does a lot of capital project management. So, and he works with local governments. He's been a county manager a number of years ago, also.
And he might have been a school superintendent at one time.
I can't remember, but
yeah, he has a vast knowledge.
Yeah.
Looking forward to that. And I'm really happy that we were able to have the opportunity for the municipalities to be included if they choose to be, because this is important area, and glad to be hosting that with them. All right, does anybody else have any comments today? Just real quick, I forgot to mention when we were doing the job descriptions earlier what the process I envision from here, get y'all's input if you disagree. So now that we have our job descriptions done, then we're going to come up with a rubric or a score sheet or an evaluation form for the direct report, circulate that to the board, so we'll all complete that. I think we'll aggregate that. You know, there'll be some stuff on there on scale 1 to 5, how are they in terms of, you know, presentation to the public or something. And so then somebody gives a 1, somebody gives a 5, and it all kind of averages out. And then in October, so we'll have a couple weeks to do that, and then there was a question about, okay, when do we evaluate the employees, because the rest of the county government gets evaluated on the anniversary of their hiring date, and we have 1 of the 4 is January, 2 are May, and 1 is October, I believe. So that's kind of spread out. So I thought that since these are people who have direct interaction and contact with the board, why would you have an evaluation in January? Because you could have somebody who's brand new to the board in January of 2021 and they don't have any experience with that person. So I thought that we would do them all in October, because then we would have the board with the most experience before we meet these folks. So we'll probably do 2 in the first meeting in October and 2 at the second meeting in October, so that we don't do them all in one night. Spread it out. Okay.
Closed session.
I apologize for my voice carrying outside the door where I had to be called out in the hall. But I had to go to the restroom, and Hugh Webster was at the elevator. And I told Hugh, I said, I want you to listen to our meeting. I wasn't going to tell this, but I am going to do it. Because he left. I want him to hear. You brought up Vietnam for some reason. But I got to tell you a story. I don't know what he was alluding to, other than things aren't as they should be. But I didn't have to go to Vietnam, but I was willing to. And when I was at Fort Jackson, South Carolina, we went down in buses. 28 boys on my bus, only 4 passed the physical, and I went up. And I turned sideways, I said, a bullet would have gone by me. So I went in, and they gave us a hearing test. I'll never forget this as long as I live. It was a little booth, like a Airstream trailer. You step up in it, you go in, there's 5-6 seats on the wall. Put on the earphones. They said, now when you hear the sound, push the button. When you don't hear it anymore, push it again. And I was like 19, 18, might have been 18. And I was nonconformist then as I am now. And I figured, I'm going to play with them a little bit. I ain't trying to get out of nothing, but I'm going to play with them. Because I didn't believe they looked at that hearing test. So when I got in, I had the same, it was like a joystick, you know, game. And I heard the noise, the shrill noise. And I waited for about a second or two. Then I pushed it. And then it was still going toward the end. I said, well, I'm going to push it again. If they looked at it, my hearing was totally screwed up. But I wasn't trying to get out of it. I was playing with it. I knew they were going. And I stepped out of that booth. They said, okay, now y'all go over and get your blood checked. I don't know what he was referring to, but that was true. And then there was a question on the back of the form where all these groups that you possibly could have been a member of or been gone to a meeting of. I won't get into that totally, but I was honest. And I checked off a certain block. A guy walked all the way from the main area out to our buses were out in the middle of nowhere. I mean, it was just a field full of buses. You've never seen it, it's unreal. He got on that bus. He says, "Is there a sighting on this bus? Back here and get out of here." And he said, "Who told you to come out here to start with?" And I said, "Well, nobody told me not to." But I can remember. And he said, "Come on back in." He said, "If you don't want any trouble," he said, "you need to come on back in and read that form." In other words, he was encouraging me to lie. So I told you, Hugh, I hope you heard that. So.
Okay. Might I add one other thing? Do you have a sheet in front of you that's blue and white, a couple of different colors of blue?
Yeah.
We were all invited to as a group, county commissioners from North Carolina, South Carolina, and Tennessee to attend a meeting back in August at the White House. It wasn't really at the White House, it was at the Eisenhower building that adjoins the White House property. It's on the White House property, but anyway. The presenter was a gentleman by the name of Doug Holscher, who's a deputy assistant to the president and director of the White House Office of Intergovernmental Affairs. And he made it clear to all of us that the rest of these speakers and everybody else was making it clear that the president is insisting that his staff do everything they can to make sure that local elected officials, local government, have access to getting answers to problems if they have them. And so one of the handouts they gave us is a list of all the different departments and the different individuals involved that are in intergovernmental affairs. This is the person you go to if somebody calls you, citizen, or we find out we're dealing with a problem. This is your go-to contact. I've given one to each of you. I've given one to Tori and to Clyde and to Brian. And can share it with any. I got you're welcome to share them with anybody you want to share them with, but I just wanted to make sure you have them.
That's terrific. Thank you very much, Commissioner Carter. Does anybody else have anything? All right, if not, we'll be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.